Hello and welcome to XTB News. Today we're going to be talking about the forthcoming University and College Union Industrial Action, which is essentially going to be a walkout of university staff. The protests themselves are going to be taking place across 14 days of escalating action, beginning on the 22nd of February and ending on the 16th of March. There are 61 universities taking place across the country. In Exeter, on a turnout of 57.5%, 92.6% of all UCU members voted for strike action. Tim Quine, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, stated in an update email sent to all university members that the university thinks that around 7.5% of all staff voted for industrial action, and that for teaching staff, this is likely higher at around 20%. So to discuss exactly why this is happening, I'm going to be joined by Dr. Zhao Florencio, a lecturer in art history and visual culture, and also the UCU Southwest Equality Officer, and Rian Keyes, a postgrad researcher here at the university, who are both planning on taking part in the action. So my first question is, just to clarify, could you just tell me a bit about what exactly the UCU itself is, who can join, who and what they represent, that kind of thing?
So UCU is the trade union for lecturers and academic related staff and professional services working in further and higher education. So it was born in 2006 after kind of two other trade unions joined together, merged together. Everyone can join, anyone working in further education or higher education, including PhD students, for whom membership is free. And beyond strike, which is actually the last thing we ever want to do, UCU lobbies universities, lobbies further education colleges on everything from, you know, just the everyday terms and conditions of employment to help kind of mediate grievances with management, mm-hmm. but also something from, you know, like equality, gender equality, pay gap, LGBT equality, student issues, so anything that we can that the membership finds useful, we then kind of lobby and work with members in the universities mm-hmm. to improve them. And also we work a lot with NUS, so they are a sister union, and we have very good relationships with them.
Yeah, perfect, yeah.
So yeah, quite a broad spectrum of people who can join, yeah. So to move on, just to kind of broadly explain why the strikes exactly are taking place and why the both of you have decided to take place. Just to say, as I understand it, it's the result of a dispute between the UCU and UUK, who is Universities UK, who are the representative body of universities themselves, over your staff pension schemes. They claim that as a result of a pension pot deficit of £12.5 billion, they want to move your pension scheme from a defined benefit scheme to a defined contribution one. So you argue that as a result of this, you're essentially going to lose a lot of your wage, your annual wage. I think it's fair to say that you were both pretty shocked when you heard them make that claim. Yeah. So yeah, if you could just elaborate on that dispute, and then also, yeah, again, personally, why you both decided to take part in the protest. So yeah, Brent, do you want to go first?
Sure. So I think for me, the key thing to get across, first of all, is that postgraduate students are also involved in this dispute. So it's not just the sort of simple lecturers are losing their pensions versus kind of students losing contract hours dispute. It's much broader than that. So people like me, I'm a postgraduate student, I teach within my department, and I stand from this strike action to lose about one third of my monthly pay. So when you're an unfunded fourth year PhD student, because as I'm sure you're aware, PhDs are funded for 3 years after four, and 48 you're writing up. So for me, that's quite a significant impact. So what would drive me to make such a sort of sacrifice for a pension scheme that as a graduate teaching assistant I don't actually have access to yet? And for me, I think it's very much around the future of the profession of academia. So these cuts will disproportionately affect younger academics. they will also disproportionately fall upon women. So this is very much for me, you know, a very personal issue, because obviously if you're starting at the beginning of your academic career, you will have longer to pay into any pension scheme that comes up. So, you know, we stand to lose kind of the worst from this. But I think also for me personally, it goes broader. It goes broader beyond the pension issue to thinking about what kind of university we want and what kind of, sort of higher education system we want in this country. So it's not just about a pension scheme, it's broader. There's a trend towards casualisation of academic labour, which again disproportionately affects younger or early career staff as well as postgraduate students. Sort of the rise of sort of the hourly paid lecturer or the hourly paid tutor. So that's, you know, that's kind of moving us away from proper contracts and sort of job security onto things where, you know, you might not know sort of where your income's coming from sort of one to the next. So there's that issue, but I think the other thing is to think about the fact that the forces behind this pension cut in terms of the market forces that are behind it are very much the same market forces that are behind the escalation in tuition fees. I think it's important to say that many of us were students in sort of 2009, 2010 when these disputes were over tuition fees were sort of coming about. Mm-hmm. And many of us were on the streets in protest against that, and UCU as our sort of representatives of our senior colleagues came out in solidarity with students, and you know UCU has always stood with students in student issues, so things like the NSS boycott, for example. So it's very much about that principle of solidarity. Mm-hmm. For me, I think also personally, it's about the it's about labour history fundamentally. And I think sort of if any of my students are watching this, they'll probably love because this is something that I talk about quite a lot. But it's about sort of the proud history of collective bargaining that this country has. It's about, you know, the ability of workers to withdraw their labour in pursuit of better working conditions and a better life. And sort of from trade union labour history, what we know, and Jack Saunders, the labour historian at UCL, has put this very succinctly when he says that, you know, the medium term prognosis for essentially where big unions lose big disputes, the medium term prognosis for sort of those industries is not good. Mm-hmm. And you know, we've certainly seen it in kind of coal industry, steel industry, dock workers. You know, when the union gets routed, pay gets cut. You get increased casualisation, you get derecognition of unions, and then, you know, the impact of that is, you know, it's not even decades before kind of the big impact on these industries. In the case of sort of coal and steel, it's been years. So for me, it's about all of those things. Yeah. Really.
Just to recap what everyone was talking about, essentially kind of the kind of market forces kind of coming into that university environment, essentially, right? Yeah. If I could just ask you quickly just to kind of go over what exactly the changes in the pension scheme system are, and then again why, as a result of that, you've also decided to take part in the action.
So the USS, it's the University Superannuation Scheme, and it's the pension scheme for academics. Mm-hmm. For academics in all the universities, so newer universities, the older, they used to be polytechnics, they have a different pension scheme. So that's why not all universities are involved in the dispute. Okay. So the Southwest is only Exeter, Bristol and Bath. Okay. What has happened is that in 2014 there was a valuation of the pension scheme to see how you know, and it was modelled, and it was decided that changes would need to be implemented for to guarantee pensions to current and future staff. Mm-hmm. Those changes were brought about, and there was another valuation last year, which actually already gives a much positive kind of paints a much positive picture of the pension scheme, so it's actually looks like it is improving. Nonetheless, the UUK, that represent the employers, the universities, decided that they need to take action on the basis of the worst possible scenario, which is, you know, what will happen given all the, you know, potential future risks to universities and to the financial situation of universities, that it may be the case that the pension scheme won't have enough money to pay everybody. So in the worst case scenario is what will happen if universities, so that's over 300 employers in the USS scheme, what happens if one by one they all go bust, yeah, and basically they all shut down, which is a pretty kind of dystopian limit situation, right? But that is the position. So in order departing from that rather speculative dark future, they have decided that we need to move from what we currently have, which is a defined benefit scheme, mm-hmm, which basically means that I know how much I will be paid every year as my pension once I retire, and that value is set. Mm-hmm. They want to move from a defined benefit to a defined contribution, which basically just means that the only thing I know is how much I'm paying in. I won't ever know until I retire how much I'll actually be earning to be paid for my pension. And that is because defined contributions, defined benefits that we currently have are a collective pension, so everyone pays together, yeah, towards the same pot, and the investment of everybody, it's currently about 25% of our salary, is invested collectively as a kind of a big pot, and then can, you know, risk can be minimized, and the returns can be higher. So they want to turn that into a personal investment, where it's just my money as an individual who will be invested into stock markets, into other financial, products, and depending on how the financial system and stock market behaves, then I will get whatever I get. Mm-hmm. And the risk is on me. So at the moment, employers and the workers as kind of a collective bear the risk. In the proposed scheme, it is myself as an individual that I'm responsible for the investment, and responsible to decide what's going to be invested in, and the risk is falls back on me. As a person. So, I mean, I know nothing about investments to start with, but you know, the various models that for instance, UCU commissioned, the valuations and the models of the various systems, show that someone at the start of the career, like myself, who, you know, is supposed to be working in at least 35 years, I am set to lose, you know, on average, 10 grand a year.
Yeah.
And this is calculated on the basis that, you know, I'm a lecturer now and I will be progressing in my career like everyone does. And, you know, by the time I retire, I may be a professor paid at the kind of the higher salary band, right? Yeah. So all that considered, and the kind of the average of my earnings, in the new model could lead me to lose about £10,000 a year. Now that's, for UCU, that's unacceptable, and it's based on a like I said, the worst case possible scenario, and excessive speculation on a kind of a doomsday future. So how do you pay pensions after the end of the world, basically? And you know, if there comes that end of the world, there are a lot more pressing issues than you know, how do you pay the pensions? You know, how do you pay pensions? But you know, you won't have universities, because that's the scenario. If everyone shuts down, if everyone goes bust, you know, what then? Mm-hmm. And you know, British higher education is a very healthy sector in the UK. We draw lots of students from all over the world. USS is one of the strongest, if not the strongest, pension scheme in the UK, and certainly one of the fourth biggest pension scheme in Europe. Mm-hmm. That says a lot about its resilience and its ability to actually unfold in a way that is much more positive than what you UK are implying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's really the reason. And there has been negotiations happening in the past until January this year with representatives of UUK and representatives of UCU, the union. And UUK are set as a group to change, to bring about these changes. UCU actually thinks no changes need to be brought about, but we are willing to get our members to pay more if employers also pay more, if indeed a change is needed. So we already tabled counter proposals to address this potential need for change, but UUK are strict that the only change is to go to stop offering defined benefit and start offering only defined contribution. So we found ourselves in no other position other than taking strike action, which is always a worst case scenario, and we are very aware of, you know, it's very hard for us, we are aware it's very hard for students, but we are kind of between a rock and a hard place, and it's really about what will be the learning, under which conditions will academics be hired in the future, under which conditions will universities be able to attract, like Exeter, to attract the best academics if we cannot provide them conditions of employment that are appealing.
Mm-hmm.
Like what education will future students of Exeter have if we cannot get the best people through the door? Because other institutions, either in the UK with different pension schemes or elsewhere around the world, may start offering better terms, better research environments, better learning environments. So I think the whole sector has to lose, including the
students. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
That's perfect. So, I mean, just to go off what you just said, how likely do you think it is that the strike will be successful? And what would a successful result look like for you?
Well, I think the best possible case scenario would be that the strike doesn't need to happen at all. UCU are very clear. I think, you know, in their communications that they want the UK to return to the negotiating table, and that is very much what the message is. And certainly, you know, as a grad student who stands to lose, as I say, a third of my income, it's going to mess up my PhD submission timetable and possibly my examination timetable as well. It's also kind of a real problem in terms of like how I'm going to eat and so on. So very much for me, you know, it's not that I want to go on strike, you know, I want this not to happen, but for that to be averted, I think there's only one option, which is to return to the negotiating table. So that would be, for me, I think, the sort of successful outcome of this is that it can be avoided, hopefully.
Yeah.
I would agree with that, and it's very much the union's position that there's still time to reinstate negotiations in a kind of a reasonable for both sides, because like we UCU has proposed alternatives, UUK has given no other alternative, defined benefit and start defined contribution. So the best case scenario is really that come the 22nd of February, that our employers will have realized the damage that the strike can create, and and perhaps even realize that these changes need not happen right now. I mean, at least they could, let's wait 3-4 years until we have more data points since the last changes were brought about. There's one data point. I mean, anyone that does any kind of data-based analysis, any kind of quantitative methods, 101, I mean, you cannot take many conclusions from one data point, right? So our employers who are academics themselves could think, maybe perhaps, you know, let's get a bigger data set to reach a conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
And that for us would be good enough.
Yeah.
Reasonable enough. Because like I said, we don't want to strike, but as a trade union, the only power that we have is the ultimate ammunition that we have is the power to withdraw our labor.
Mm-hmm.
As painful as that can be, but it's really a last case scenario.
Yeah.
Okay. But what students can do, maybe you are asking me what students can do.
Well, that's actually going to be the last question. So I was actually going to go for the slightly more negative question, first of all, which is, so currently on the Guild's Student Ideas page, there is a very entitled, "The Guild Should Support the Upcoming UCU Strike Action." And of the 414 votes that have been cast at the time of the video, 65.4% are strongly agree, 7.7% are at agree. So obviously there's like, of people who voted, there's majority consensus that you guys should be supported by the Guild. 19.6%, however, have voted that they strongly disagree with the notion. And to be fair, I think that does stem from a very valid concern that many students have, that obviously, you know, 2 weeks over a month period of their tuition time and learning is going to be affected. For someone like me, who's a humanities subject, a humanities student, I do politics and history, you know, I only have 6 hours a week. One of my tutors out of the two is striking, so really at the end of the day, a few hours of reading, that's all I need to catch up. Say if you're a STEM student, however, who spends like 3 days in the lab, that is going to be a huge amount of time that they just will not be able to catch up on, that they've lost as a result of the strike action if their tutors do so. So, I mean, could you comment at all on like the validity of those concerns, and also what steps you guys have taken to minimise that potential damage that could happen to your students?
Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the first thing to say, of course, is that this is not a, it's not a simple sort of students versus lecturers dichotomy at all, because students are involved in this dispute, and I think that's one of the things that has perhaps been quite disappointing about the Guild's initial response, which was to express sympathies with both sides,
mm-hmm.
Where one side is the Guild's own members in precarious employment situations.
Yeah.
Having said that, you know, none of us want to take strike action, and as I said earlier, you know, the ideal situation for all of us would be that the negotiations are reopened as soon as possible, so that we don't have to spend any time out of the classroom.
Yeah.
I love teaching. It's not just, you know, I mean, I've mentioned, so, you know, I'd like to be able to eat and pay the bills and all that, but it's not about that for me. I love teaching. I love my students. I love teaching them. I love watching them grow. I love learning from them too. You know, the classroom for me is very much a kind of mutual exchange where I really benefit from my students' ideas. So it's not a simple dichotomy, because, you know, there are students involved in this too, and we wouldn't be doing it if we didn't believe it was necessary. Like, fundamentally, what this represents is an existential threat to the quality of higher education.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I think the kind of motives behind the industrial dispute and behind the action proposed by UCU is actually about improving conditions, because, you know, our working conditions are also your study conditions, but my study conditions too. And I think that's often what's getting lost in this debate. So you know, the ideal thing, and you know, that's definitely what you know what we're pushing for is for this never to need to happen at all.
Yeah.
And you know, that would be for me, I think, the ideal outcome of this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there is going to be the if the strike was ahead, of course, lectures and seminars, contact hours are going to be disrupted. And the concerns of students are valid, and we all empathize with them, and because it's also our work that is going to be disrupted, right? It's the things that we like to do that are going to be disrupted, as well as our income that is are going to be disrupted. But students' concerns are relevant and shouldn't be minimized, and that's why we think and UCU thinks that students should raise their concerns with the management at their institutions, because it is our position that we find, it is UCU's position that we are at, we've come to this stage, to this limit stage, right, where we actually had to decide to go on strike, to take strike action, because of the resistance of UUK to negotiate further. It's a very hard line position that they've taken. No scope, no flexibility, no scope to reconsider. It is not UCU's position. UCU has proposed alternatives to has tried to move closer to UUK's position, and it has not been the case. It has not been reciprocated. Mm-hmm. So any concerns students have, they should by all means raise it with the institutions, in the understanding that both students and staff are ultimately being damaged by this situation. In terms of minimizing, that there is no so there is no legal duty for lectures or seminars to be rescheduled. Mm-hmm. If they fall on the strike days. Assessment, however, will not be affected, so it will have to be rescheduled. Mm-hmm. Because this is not a marking boycott.
Yeah.
It could have been, there have been marking boycotts in the past, but we realize that marking boycotts have a massive impact on students. So institutions will have to reschedule assessment, and those assessments will have to take place. In terms of the disruption of lectures and seminars, UCU's position is that the work should not be delivered after the strike day, because what that does is you know, if we come to a position where we feel we have no other option but to take strike action, the only aim of strike action is to stop offering our labor to employers, and our labor in this case is to teach and to do research, and you know it's like the you know, if the tube drivers strike and everyone gets annoyed, but it's the only way they can, it's the only thing they can do if they've been pushed against the wall. And I hope students understand that, and I hope they understand that this is also about their education, about the education of the ones that will come after you.
Yeah.
So concerns, please direct them to management.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, it's really clear that obviously you guys care a lot about your students. I just want to come to what you said, yeah, about it not being a marking boycott and things like that, assessment won't be affected. So, I mean, really, I do have to ask the question of how effective is the strike then, really? I mean, if you guys are still marking papers, like, you're still ultimately going to come back to teaching, I mean, is it really the most effective form of striking, especially when it is one that can so easily be taken to be a kind of lecturer versus student split kind of event. Yeah, is there anything else you could have done? I'd like saying like framing it against the private pensions that people in the higher management of the university get. Is there a better way to bring about this message, I guess is what I'm saying.
I mean, I can try to say something.
yeah. But,
if there's another way to do it, we've tried it. We tried to talk, and we tried to propose alternative changes. We tried to. We used independent companies that gave us different prognostics about the future of the pension scheme. So there is no certainty that the position that UK are taking is dubious. I mean, the premise for that position is dubious. But we're still accepting to, if you want to make changes, we will accept some changes, but not that. And we were constantly told that would not be possible. And, it is not a staff student situation, it is an employer employee situation. The dispute is not with students. And students ought to realize that. Your relationship is with the university. Your relationship is with an institution, and as part of that institution, you have relationships with academics. But don't forget that institution is both a learning institution, but it's also a workplace. And there's also relationships between staff and the management of institutions, and those relationships needs to be cared for, needs to be good, and staff needs to believe in what they're doing in order to create the best learning space for students. And that's what we risk losing increasingly. And I think if students realize that, if students realize that you'll still have your degree, you still have your assessments, you might lose some contact hours, some lectures, but might it not be a just cause, like a strong enough cause, if we're thinking that this is the biggest attack on terms and conditions of academic employment ever. If we don't do anything about it, we actually risk damaging the future of higher education in this country. So I think students I understand the need to think about your individual position at any stage. But if I were to think about my present position, I'd be thinking about my monthly wage next month. I wouldn't take action because I'd just be thinking about now. Mm. And my now is I need a monthly wage. But I'm thinking actually about my pension. I'm thinking 30 years from now, 35 years from now. Can students think 35 years from now and think the kind of higher education they want in this country? And I think this goes into that, right? This fits into that. So it is about sometimes recognizing what is being fought for, and recognizing that it is not a selfish thing of academics wanting to just get a cushy pension or something. It's more than that. So maybe there's this kind of looking the potential positive negative impact that if we don't act on this right now, that things might be quite gloomy in the future for everybody. So I mean, yeah, I think that's it.
I think for me, as speaking as a obviously as a postgrad student, it's immensely clear to me that actually we're all on the same side here, because I think it's a difference between those of us who are financially impacted by this system, whether it's by escalating tuition fees, whether it's by a tax on working conditions. It's the same forces behind it all. So for me, that's the key point. But you know, to go a little bit back to, you know, the principles behind sort of trade unionism, I think the key thing here is, you know, it's about the right to collectively bargain, and it's about, you know, the right to kind of stand up and say, actually, you know, these working conditions are not, or these attacks on our working conditions are not acceptable. Because fundamentally, you know, academics aren't asking for more money or asking for sort of anything that we haven't got. We're not asking for anything extra. We're asking for, you know, the stuff that is already in place to remain the same, or, you know, at least for any changes to be sort of reasonable. And I think, you know, that essentially, as we've already said, strike action, whilst, you know, we'd rather avoid that, it is the only way that, you know, we can negotiate. But it goes beyond the higher education sector as well, because I think there's a lot of kind of misinformation around, you know, well, this is a cushy pension. Well, I think everybody should have cushy pensions. I think, you know, the defined benefit scheme is a good idea, and I think, you know, if we can fight this one and we can win it, then maybe, you know, it will inspire workers in other sectors to also organise and unionise and fight for better conditions for themselves as well. So it's broader, it's about the broader labour movement. Yeah. It's not just about this sector.
Yeah. I mean, So just to round off, really, for any students who are inclined to do so, what is their best way to support the strike action? Who wants to take it first?
So I think one of the things that has been most heartening for me in the last few days has been the real overwhelming student solidarity with workers at this university. So as you mentioned, there's the large idea on the guild's website, which students have come out sort of overwhelmingly in favour of, and it's that student solidarity that's really important to me. I had a student come up to me at the end of a seminar on Tuesday, and he said to me, I just want you to know that I support the strike, and I also support the social forces behind the strike, and I will be honest, I had to excuse myself because I went and I wept like a baby, because, you know, it's been such a tough decision. I've lost sleep over my decision to vote in favour of the strike action. I don't want to let my students down. You know, I love working with them. A student campaign in favour of supporting the ECU position on this, and you can get in touch with the organisers of that. There's a Facebook and a Twitter. You can engage with this and, you know, find out how you can get involved in supporting your lecturers and your tutors. One of the big things at the moment, particularly for me as a fellow student, is the large idea on the Guild website. That's going to be open, I think, until the 14th of February, and it does need 475 votes to essentially become quorate and be able to change the Guild's position, which, you know, I've made my opinions on patently clear. And, you know, we're not that far off. We're, you know, I think you said 414 at the time of recording. So we're not that far off. So, you know, students can go and you can both strongly agree with that idea, which would force the Guild to change its position, which, as I say, has been shameful up to this point. The other things that you can do, you could join us on the picket line. You can stand in solidarity with us, and indeed not cross the picket lines. That would be something that we would be asking students to do. And I think also, as has already been said, you know, make your discontent with the situation and, you know, the failure of Universities UK and senior managers to return from negotiating table. Students, you know, you have a really powerful voice. I think if anything's going to avert this strike, it is student dissatisfaction. So, you know, make those views known, make clear that, you know, you support a return to negotiations and that you support UCU's position. Because I think it's, if anything's going to stop this strike from happening, it will be that.
Yeah, I would also mention that there will be a local hardship fund to help especially those early academics and PGR students who are also GTIs, who will be struggling a lot financially for taking strike action. The joining the picket line, you know, to go back to the issue of losing contact hours, the picket line is a great place of learning, and it is, and we are planning rallies, we're planning teach outs. There's people in various departments already developing ideas to create to use the strike action to create an opportunity to talk to students, to talk for staff to talk amongst themselves, but to engage with the local community, to talk about, you know, the university, what university do we want, to talk about the history of trade unionism, to talk about, you know, to teach each other about pensions. So there are lots of other opportunities to learn in that context, and learning that, you know, is as valuable. And again, one of the ideas that has been circulating around would be that it's the 100 years that women, at least some women, first got the right to vote. Why not teach about the history of the suffragette movement? Why not teach about, you know, history of the feminist movement? I mean, it's also the 150 years of the Trades Union Council. Teach about the very long history of trade unionism in Britain. That is such a powerful and beautiful history. I mean, there's so much to learn on the picket line in various teach out locations, and students are definitely invited to all of this because we'd love to have you there.
Yeah. Amazing. So, I mean, unless you guys have anything else that you'd like to add. No?
Yeah, there you go.
No? Yeah, so I might just round off there. Students are welcome to join the outdoors classroom. Just
gonna might be indoors if you want.
Wrap up warm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you chose the worst time of the year. So yeah, thank you so much for joining me. I will link the kind of the student idea for the Guild support, the to support the action, to vote however they please. It's open until the 14th of February, I think you said. So, yeah, again, just, yeah, thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you for watching.